Now about the basics of logics. Here we have a so-called argument. I have two assumptions. In this case it is raining, and if it rains the ground is wet. And then with the help of a logical rule, which in this case is called modus ponens, I can derive the conclusion the ground is wet. The modus ponens, that means I have two statements like this. So one is just a circumstance that is given, like it is raining, and the other is a if then condition. In this case, if it rains, the ground is wet. And the first statement is the left side, or the condition, or the antecedents of those conditional. So that means I know that the right side of the conditional must be true. In this case, the ground is wet. So when I'm having an argument with another person, and the other person accepts my two assumptions, or whatever amount of assumptions I have, and then I'm drawing a conclusion based on these assumptions with logics, then the other person has to also accept my conclusion as well, because when I'm using rules from logics, there's no way that if the assumptions are true that the conclusion I draw is false when I'm using logical rules. So now we are having one argument here, but there are millions of similar arguments of the same form, where I have one statement given and one if-then sentence, where the first condition is the same as one sentence given. So we can abstract from that, and then it looks like this. This is the same situation as before, but we have but it's more formal, and we don't really care anymore what these sentences specifically mean. We can just apply them to anything we need. So it is the same as before. So P is our it rains, and Q is the ground is wet. And so the second line now means if it rains, then the ground is wet. Though there are many people understand different things when I say something with if then. So there are people who don't read P then Q, but they would read P arrow Q or something. Just as a note. So, and we now have written an A here, saying that this is our assumption. So here in those column, it says where we got a line from. We have those line numbering, and here we also have some stars, and they will be important later on, because I can also make new assumptions out of nowhere. But if I want the other person to accept the conclusion I'm drawing, then the conclusion must only depend on my initial assumptions. So that means the stars, they say from how many assumptions one line depends on, and the last conclusion I'm drawing must have the same amount of stars as my last initial assumption. So in this case we also have the modus ponens here written down, saying that this line was derived with the help of modus ponens, and we also have here the numbers that tell us which lines we applied modus ponens on to derive our new line. Now we are coming to a slightly longer example. So here we have something like task given. Here we have those symbol. This is the implication symbol. I'm not sure if there's another term for it in English. So this is a semantic symbol. This is not part of the logic formula itself, but it's a meta symbol. And the meaning is somehow different, somehow the same to the arrow. So that means if the left part of the symbol is, of the implication is true, then the right side must also be true. And in this logic system, which is the system of the calculus of natural deduction, if this is true, if there's an implication, then we can also, then there's also a derivation from the left side to the right side. And the symbol for the derivation would look the same like this, but only with one horizontal bar. So, if we now have the task given, we can prove that this is true by performing a derivation from the left part to the right part. So we are using the left side here as our initial assumption, as line 1 with line star. And now you are free to pause the video and try to figure out your own solution to this problem. So, or you can also keep on watching if you need more hints. So, in the first step, I see that here we have another conditional, and one good strategy when we have a conditional that we want to prove is that we are making the left side of this, the antecedents, a new assumption, and then try to derive the right side of it. So here I'm making a new assumption, which is not part of my initial assumption, so I write it in these brackets, in squared brackets, and I have to add another star because this is a new assumption. And here I have those, I don't need to write the round brackets because this is just the whole expression. So, but this is, I'm just assuming that the left side is correct, is true. So I could do any kind of assumption that I want, but here I'm doing especially one that I think will help me to prove, to fulfill the task. Now, as you can see here, we have P and Q in those assumptions. And if we have those N, those, what was the name? So you know that if I have those N, then you know that both parts must be true. So if every part of this is true, then I know that one of this is also true. So I can apply a new rule I have not introduced to you yet. But this is called the end removal. I'm not sure if there's if there are some other names for it in English. But basically, now I'm applying it to line 2, and I can just get one of those parts. In this case, I picked P. And now, as you can see, I already introduced the rule modus ponens to you, and as you can see here, now P, I have a single P, which is already the left side, the condition of the conditional, so I can apply modus ponens to lines 3 and 1 to get me the right side of those arrow. In this case, now I got Q, then R. Now, here I have another conditional, And I need, well, I want to have, I need a single queue. And now, as I already told you before, here I know that both parts must be true, so I can apply the end removal again on line 2 and get a single queue. So now, as you can see, the queue is the left-hand side of this line, so I can apply modus ponens on line 4 and 5 again to get me a single R. So now I have those single R that's here on this side of my task. And now I need another rule which I have not introduced to you yet. But if I make an assumption, so I'm assuming that the assumption I made is true, and I derive something which now I know must be true if the assumption is also true, because you see it has the same amount of stars. So if I say if this is true, then also this is true, this is exactly what we need for the conditional. So we have another rule for introducing a conditional, which is applied on the line of my last assumption and on a line of something that I derived from that. So I'm applying the conditional introduction on the line of my last assumption and on something I derived from those assumptions. And then I got this new line with the assumption on the left side of the arrow and the thing that I derived from that on the right side. Now I'm allowed to remove one of the stars, and as you can see here now, this is exactly what I wanted to derive. So I know that this formula is true because I found a derivation that just proves that it is true. Now, in a summary, you see we have those lines with different numbers. We have those, we have sentences or expressions or formulas or how one you want to call them. We have some rules, we have some set of rules which we can use on different expressions to give us new expressions, and we have those pointers that tell us which lines were used to derive new lines. Please keep this in mind because we will need it later on in other videos.